The Philippine Embassy in Lebanon strongly urging Filipinos to leave the country as tensions escalate. It says Filipinos should prioritize their safety and consider leaving Lebanon while commercial flights are still available. Those who wish to remain are advised to exercise extreme caution and remain in contact with the embassy. And joining us now in Hot Copy, we have with us DFA Undersecretary Eduardo De Vega. Good morning, Undersecretary. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning.
All right. Undersecretary, let's first begin with an update on whether or not there are actually Filipinos who were killed or were hurt in the series of attacks in Lebanon.
Well, that's the positive news I could share. Absolutely no report that any Filipino was among those affected. You will note from the announcement by the Hezbollah leader that the victims were all, connected with Hezbollah. And we'd like to think there are no Filipino citizens who are members of Hezbollah. So no Filipinos reported injured during the successive days of the attacks.
Okay, that's some good news to start this Friday morning. But paint to us a picture of what is currently happening in Lebanon and how this series of attacks has actually affected the Filipino community there.
Let's remember that the tensions in Lebanon did not simply occur in the past few days. Ever since the war between the Israelis and the Palestinians in Gaza occurred last October, there have already been a lot of tensions in the Israel-Lebanon border, in the south of Lebanon and north of Israel. So we have been already repatriating Filipinos who wish to go home. Lebanon now is under alert level 3, voluntary repatriation. In other words, the Philippine government has already been encouraging for several months the Filipino community to consider going home because of the tensions in the area. And now we're going to renew, as you heard, renew the calls. There have been about more than 500 who have gone home and about 1,000 still planning to go home out of the 11,000 Filipinos. We're simply awaiting the later support of the embassy as to whether we should increase the alert level to the highest, alert level 4, meaning mandatory evacuation, instructing the Filipinos already to go home. In that case, we'll have to be making the necessary preparations.
All right. Undersecretary, before we talk about the threshold of the alert levels of, and before when the DFA should actually call for a mandatory repatriation, let's first talk about the number of Filipinos there. You mentioned that there are about 11,000 there. 500 have already gone home to the country. What's keeping the other Filipinos there? Why are they still staying? What are they telling the embassy?
There are two basic reasons. One, they would be afraid of not being able to return. If they go home, they might not be able to get back. After all, they don't want to lose their jobs. Number two, despite the tensions in the south, and despite any tension felt by the citizens residing in Lebanon, life goes on in the parts of Lebanon where there are many Filipinos, specifically in Beirut, the capital, and towards the north. So the Filipinos there continue working, continue receiving the salaries from their employers, and feel that, I don't feel there's a war. Of course, there are Filipinos who decided to go home, but the majority are saying, well, this is normal in this region. There's always tension between Israel and Lebanon, with Israel and Hezbollah, to be specific. So we're going to stay. And this is not an unusual phenomenon. You see that in almost any area where there are flashpoints. Filipinos would prefer to stay unless, for example, the entire area is already unlivable because of the war. A good example would be Sudan last year. That's when Filipinos decided to go home. Now, Lebanon so far, if you know, there are still flights to Lebanon. You go to Lebanon, at least to Beirut. We Filipinos might be aware of that, especially those of a certain age. World News might report of hostility somewhere in the south, and yet people in Luzon or in certainly Metro Manila would not feel anything, and therefore that would explain it. Nevertheless, The Hezbollahs are threatening retaliation. Israel continues its attacks. Well, we assume it's Israel, of course. Eventually the Filipinos will have to reconsider. We'll update you on this.
Undersecretary, that kind of reasoning of Filipinos in Lebanon, them saying that the situation in their area, particularly in northern Lebanon, is still quite stable, does that actually placate the DFA? Do you actually see that as a valid reason for them to stay? Or are there continuing efforts to continue to convince them to come home already?
We can't force them to go home if they wish to stay. But we continue to try to convince them, and our embassy continues to make preparations in case there will be a mass evacuation. They are updating their contingency plan. They're meeting the Filipinos regularly in order to provide them update situation. They are preparing all the emergency kits, the materials that will be needed. They're meeting with Lebanese immigration officials to facilitate the issuance of necessary clearances for the exit. So their area coordinators, there's shelters, they're talking about how to depart from Lebanon in case the airport is closed. So the embassy continues to operate as if eventually Filipinos in Lebanon will go home. It happened about 15 years ago. Mm-hmm. We repatriated thousands upon thousands of Filipinos and from Lebanon, and many they went back. So, well, a common expression they make is, mabuti na mamatay sa gera kaysa mamatay sa gutom. Well, it's wrong to die for any reason. So our belief is better to be safe. So we're operating as if eventually they will go home.
Mm-hmm. Undersecretary, what precautions is the DFA advising to Filipinos in Lebanon, considering that basic gadgets were used to detonate the series of blasts that happened in Lebanon in recent days?
Well, you can't really do anything if there is a country or an organization which managed to make such an operation resulting in the deaths of many Hezbollah members. In other words, we cannot advise Filipinos not to operate cell phones. That's why the embassy is just informing the Filipinos to, as much as possible, just stay at home or at your workplace and not make any necessary travels around the country. And of course, you will note that according to the reports, what's been happening is that these are new devices which were imported into Lebanon.
Right. Allegedly devices from Taiwan that passed through, allegedly through Hungary. But then when they check Taiwan and Hungary, both say that they were not ordered from there. Basically, sketchy things happening there. Undersecretary, give us a profile, a picture of what Filipinos are actually doing in Lebanon. Are they engaged in hotel work, in tourism work, in domestic care? Is a chunk of them actually married to Lebanese nationals?
The majority are household workers. Many are undocumented because they did not arrive there direct from the Philippines, but from other countries in the region, for example, from the Gulf. Despite what I said that the majority are household workers, there are a number of Filipinos there who are also skilled workers, a few teachers, a few office workers, hospital workers, people in the hospitality business. So, of course, we make those distinction between profession. One thing I want to emphasize, those who are saying they want to go home tend to be the ones who just barely arrived in Lebanon. Those who arrived like within the last year or two. Those who have already been there for many years and are quite used to the situation in the area, whether they're household workers or not, are saying they'll go home. They won't go home, they'll stay. One complication as well is that it takes time to get an exit clearance from Lebanon, because apparently a lot of them, a majority of the 11,000 may have expired work visas or don't have the work visa, so it's taking some time. So are there Filipinos married to Lebanese? A few, but they do not comprise anywhere near a big percentage of Filipinos in Lebanon.
Okay.
The point being made is that they feel safe.
That's a lot of challenge that the DFA is actually facing. First, the number of undocumented workers. Around how many are we talking about here? Because it's going to be very hard to process their exit visas if they scramble at the last minute.
Well, that's why we're already in touch with the Lebanese immigration officials to facilitate the process. I'm pretty sure it's been done before that the Lebanese will not complicate things in case, and we hope there is not such a thing, in case it boils down to a full war. But again, the majority of the hostilities are only in the southern border of Lebanon, where the Israelis and the Hezbollahs fire back and forth. And there are no Filipinos practically in that area.
All right.
Right at the border.
Okay.
So we'll update you on this.
Okay. Undersecretary, since you already mentioned Israel, let's talk about the other side of this war. Security analysts expect, as you mentioned earlier, Hezbollah to retaliate against Israel after the series of deadly bombings. Is the Philippine government also advising Filipinos in Israel to leave that country as soon as possible?
No. According to our ambassador in Israel, it's only precautions they're taking. There are no voluntary or mandatory repatriation programs in place. However, there also have been Filipinos who have gone home already. In fact, it could reach over 1,000 Filipinos who have gone home since October, if you remember the attack on Israel and the Israeli retaliation in Gaza. So we'll be asking the embassy, and we're awaiting the reports if they feel that we should update or elevate the alert level. One thing important to say, the Israelis have told the Philippine government, in fact, they told me personally when I was there several months ago, that all the protections that they will provide there, that they provide their citizens in case of external attack, are also offered to Filipinos and other foreign workers there. And so that's something that the Filipinos know. And that's why they're in Israel, perhaps more than in Lebanon. They already feel at home and do not plan to remain. At any rate, the majority of Hezbollah attacks in Israel are against the northern Israel area. The bulk of Filipinos, about 30,000 in Israel, are in Tel Aviv and surrounding areas. So they do not receive the attacks that we see from the north of Israel.
Mm-hmm.
I must like to emphasize that the Philippine government, of course, joins the world community in hoping for a peaceful solution in the Middle East.
All right. Undersecretary, the October 7th attack, the anniversary, is already quite near. It's happening in a few days, if not a few weeks. Should this be any cause of concern? What do intelligence reports tell you?
Unfortunately, what they indicate is that despite all the attempts by the U.S. and some countries in the Middle East to broker a peace deal between the Israelis and the Hamas, we don't seem to be closer to achieving it. And that's the problem. Not that we fear that on October 7th there'll be a major event. No. However, we need peace in Gaza so that that kind of peace would also spread to other conflicts in the region. For example, there's the Lebanon conflict. The Hezbollah have also said that the peace in Gaza or the cessation of hostilities is essential. We have the Houthis in Yemen, who are in fact up to now holding some foreign crewmen hostage, including 17 Filipino seafarers. And they say the only way they will release them is in case or after any war between the Israelis and the Palestinians in Gaza ends. And that's why we're hoping that eventually all these measures being conducted by supportive or friendly countries will succeed, and that we'll see some sort of a ceasefire, a permanent ceasefire in the area, and that will spread towards a more peaceful situation in the entire region.
Okay, no imminent threat yet happening as the October 7 anniversary nears. But very quick question, Undersecretary. Since you already mentioned the 17 seafarers, Filipino seafarers, who are still being held hostage, these are the seafarers from MV Galaxy, correct?
Correct.
Any update?
Galaxy leader.
Okay, any update with regard to their situation there? Still no signs of their captors actually finally setting them free?
Unfortunately, still no signs. Our honorary consul in Yemen is making the plans to go visit the ship again. Let's remember, the part where the Houthi rebels are controlling is not the official part of Yemen, which is recognized by the Philippines and other countries. The Houthi, shall we say, government operates from the old capital of Sana'a, while it's in Aden, in the central and eastern parts of Yemen, which have the what is recognized as the legitimate government. So that complicates our efforts to have peace, to resolve the situation. The all of government approach with the DFA and the DMW and other agencies is working to at least contact the next of kin here, the families, to make sure that the crewmen are in regular contact, because they are allowed to contact their families about once a week. And there are occasions that they don't contact them, so we check up on them.
All right.
Again, maybe reiterate the call for their release. Through our work, through the Philippine Initiative, the UN Human Rights Council in Geneva passed a resolution calling on the protection of human rights of all seafarers. So that would include their right not to be taken hostage. So we still are hoping that there will be a solution to this soon, soonest.
Undersecretary, please explain to our viewers what makes the case of these seafarers aboard the MV Galaxy special, because we already saw rescue attempts or a successful rescue missions for MV Tutor and other similar vessels that w where Filipinos were actually attacked or taken hostage. Why is the Philippine government taking, why is it a challenge for Filipino officials to actually bring home these 17 Filipino seafarers who have been held captive as early as late last year, if I'm not mistaken?
Yes, as early as late last year. And
Okay.
that's the reason they were the first to be taken captive.
And why is
Let me
their
see.
situation
They were the
more
first to be
difficult?
taken captive. And we were not. Yes. In the other attacks, the world community was already prepared to provide us in the Red Sea. Not so when the Galaxy leader passed. The number one problem is that the Houthis are not asking for money. If you remember, there were some Filipino seafarers being taken by Iran aboard a certain ship which was confiscated. They only wanted replacement seafarers. So there were seafarers from other countries who took the place of the Filipinos in Iran. In the Houthis, what they want is the end to secession, to the hostilities in Gaza. And that's something that's beyond our control. That is what is complicating things.
Okay, a very difficult situation there for the 17 Filipino seafarers there. Finally, Undersecretary, before we let you go, you have been mentioning that the DFA will update the public with regard to an announcement of a mandatory repatriation for Filipinos either in Lebanon or in Israel. Talk to us, what threshold needs to be breached for the Philippine government to actually heighten alert levels or travel advisory warnings to go to Lebanon? And when will these repatriation flights actually be mounted?
Well, the repatriation flights are essentially through commercial flights. And in case the airports close, we do not use repatriation flights. We use the ports. That's how we evacuated Filipinos from Libya and other countries over 10 years ago during the Arab Spring. And that's why we're telling the Filipinos in Lebanon and Israel, go home now while it's easy to get commercial flights paid by the government. The threshold is if the situation is such that there's a breakdown of peace and order in the country. In other words, if there's a scale of full war situation in the host country. And I'm awaiting the report of Ambassador Balatbat in Beirut. If he feels that the situation already calls for it.
All right.
At any rate, with an all of government approach, we will use all the resources necessary to bring them home.
All right, and we will have to leave it at that for now. We will have to wait and see on how far or how close we actually are from that very violent situation happening in Lebanon that would trigger a mandatory repatriation here. Thank you so much for making time for us this morning, Undersecretary Eduardo De Vega.
Thank you, and have a good day.